Verse 1, and now a word to you who are elders in the church. I too am an elder and a witness to the sufferings of Christ, and I too will share in his glory when he is revealed to the whole world. As a fellow elder, I appeal to you. So Peter is saying, I am not above you. I am not the Pope. I am not anyone special. I too am an elder. But I do have a little bit up on you because I have witnessed his sufferings and I also witnessed his glory on the Mount of Transfiguration. Did you see that, Cheryl?
Yes.
You did. Oh, we have Cheryl here who has just returned from Israel, and I just can't imagine what it was like to be there and walk where Jesus walked. But Peter was there, and he says, I saw his glory. I saw his sufferings, like you have not seen his sufferings, and I have seen his glory. But yet, I am still a fellow elder. So, you know, I like it that he's putting himself on regular ground. He's not lording himself over the rest of us.
Care for the
verse
flock
two says, that God has entrusted to you. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you will get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. That's the reason that we're to watch over the flock. Now, we're overseers too. We will never be pastors as women, as we should not be. We will never be elders, as we should not be. But we're still overseers of somebody and something, you know,
to
look out for them, especially those, and maybe there are some people who we've led to Christ, you know, and they've wandered away. Last week I talked about one of the gals that I led to Christ, and it fell on rocky soil. The seed fell on rocky soil, and she's gone away. You know, we shouldn't just let that happen. As her overseer, and I say that lightly, because I was the one that led her to Christ, I kind of was responsible to shepherd her and to make everything sure everything was okay. And when it comes right down to it, they make their own choices. People make their own choices. We are not the Holy Spirit. We cannot force them to be someone who walks with Christ if they don't want to be. But nevertheless, we do have a responsibility toward other Christians, especially those who are weaker, those who have fallen away, even if it's a friend, or people maybe we haven't seen at church for a while. Give them a call. Send them a text. Just let them know that they're missed. It means a lot, and it could make the difference of bringing them back or not. Luke 15:4. I want to read that to you if you want to write that down or turn there if you want.
What was it?
Luke 15:4. That's where Jesus is talking about the lost sheep. Luke 15:4. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that one which is lost until he finds it? And, you know, so it's really important. I think these first verses, we tend to think, yeah, those are the elders. That's what those elders need to be doing. That's what our pastor needs to be doing. And yes, they are. I mean, it is a command to them. But I think, again, that should apply to all of us. Do you not? Should it fall on their shoulders? Can one man and a few elders, a pastor and a few elders, really take care of the whole flock? We need to do what we can to
we don't do the
ministry for money. We know that. But to be eager about, if you're been called to be a Sunday school teacher, be an eager. Don't do it grudgingly. Oh, I've got to teach Sunday school. You know, but I guess if you have to do it grudgingly, you probably shouldn't be doing it, right? But to do it eagerly, because it's whatever you're doing, do it. Because God has given you a gift for whatever that duty is. You're gifted to do it. So do it. And do it cheerfully and joyfully as unto the Lord, right? So our motivation, though, should stem from that internal call of God, not anything else. Not because anyone's pressuring us, or not because we ourselves put ourselves in a position where we think, oh, I should be doing this. I should be doing, you know, that is not of God. So pray, you know, we can't do everything. We can't be all things to all people, but pray and ask God, where do you want me to serve? Because he's given us gifts to use to serve somewhere, somehow. Verse 3 says, don't lord it over the people assigned to your care, whoever those people are, but lead them by your own good example. 1 Timothy 4:12, Paul is saying to Timothy, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set an example for the believers in speech. Okay, think about this. In speech, do we set an example for other believers? That's what he says. Set an example for the believers in speech. But I would like to add to that and say even unbelievers, right? We want, if we're proclaiming the name of Jesus, then, and people are watching and they know that we're Christians, then we have a responsibility to be imitators of him in the best way we can. So speech is the first thing Paul says. The next thing is in conduct. Even, and it's hard when we're out there in the world and things go wrong and that driver pulls out in front of you and you want to blast your horn. And, you know, I told you about my station wagon I used to drive that had the window that you rolled down. And if I ever did anything stupid, I'm driving down the road and I do something, you know, that I'd always roll that window down because it said Jesus is Lord on the bottom. And I didn't want them to hold it against Jesus.
If we have a bumper sticker on our car that says the name of Jesus,
we better be the most meticulous drivers out there on the highway,
speech,
right? In conduct. And I'm talking all those little things that happen at the on the job. You know, things that happen with our family, things that happen with Aaron, you know, Warren. We don't have to be out there in the world to mess up with our speech and our conduct, do we? Bob, Dwayne, you know, it's just, and the kids at school. So we just need to be on guard. I don't want to leave Pastor out either, you know, but that conduct, to be an example. Maybe they're not behaving the way they should, but... Yeah. Sometimes,
you know,
when Warren is so sweet to me, when I know that he probably shouldn't be, that I probably deserve a little bit of his ire, and he's so sweet, that just kind of makes me feel worse. It does. And he's setting an example, and it's like, oh, I need to be more like that, you know? So we can do it for them too. It goes both ways. But in love, How do we love? How do we demonstrate that love in terms of our behavior toward that?
What do you do?
How do these Christians act when something goes wrong on the job? Or, you know, you're in a situation where something bad has happened to you. The world is watching. And then it says, and impurity. Impurity. So these are all important. These are ways that we can conduct ourselves that would bring honor and glory to Jesus and to help us set a good example. So we as women can be women of prayer, women who worship God, women of compassion, all those things that would set us apart as being peculiar people, which God says we are. How are we peculiar? Well, we're peculiar not by being strange and weird, but by being different than what the world is. And so verse 4 then goes on and it says, and when the great shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of never-ending glory and honor. Don't you look forward to that day? Wow. And what are we going to do with the crowns that Jesus gives to us? We get to lay them at his feet. What a day that is going to be. What honor that's going to be. You know, the day will come when all those things that we've done that maybe have gone unnoticed, the little things you do that no one even sees, but the Lord sees. And we will be rewarded. And I want to have lots of rewards that I can turn around and lay at the feet of Jesus. But not everything I've done is going to be, I won't get a crown for everything. And why not?
Because we've done it with the wrong purpose in mind. We've done it for the glory or for the, to get the, not the crown, but to, sometimes we do things so that we can edify ourselves.
Right. To edify ourselves or to make ourselves look good to the public. Sometimes
I did the right thing.
Look at me. We don't even know our own heart sometimes. You know, God has to even reveal our heart to us through His Holy Spirit. And there are things that we might not even know. We might think we had pure motives, but they weren't. He knows. He knows ourselves. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And those works are going to be burned up. Everything is going to be just like we talked last week with the fire. Those things that were wood, hay, and stubble are going to burn up, and they won't be there. And only the pure works that we did to glorify Him will remain. And we won't know, I guess, until that day what's going to happen. But let's look at verse 5. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders, and all, and it's that word all of you, dress yourselves in humility as you relate to one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Wow, that's a powerful
word. We want to be recipients of His grace. We don't want Him to oppose us.
Do you want God to oppose you? I don't. That's a scary thought, really. You know, we kind of gloss over that part. Oh, God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. That's a scary thought. To be in the position where God is opposing you, the God of the universe, yikes. So, pride and grace, they're both in that word, in that verse. God opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. And those two words are eternal enemies. They cannot coexist. And I want to be on the side of grace. I don't know about you. Where he says to be clothed, that translates, and it's a rare word, but it means like a slave putting on an apron before serving. That's what that word clothed means. We don't have an English word that quite says that. And it's the same thing that Jesus did before he washed his disciples' feet. And that's in John 13, verses 4 and 5. So it's, in fact, I had a pastor one time that said, you know, we Christians, we don't have a bit of trouble wearing a cross necklace. We put those crosses on and we wear them. Or we put a cross, you know, on our rearview mirror. We put crosses on our walls and our houses.
Wearing a cross, and this lady came up to me and she says, does that mean anything to you? And I thought, that is such a neat question to ask a person. So I was able to talk to her about what it meant to me.
Oh, that is really neat. Was she a believer?
Yeah.
Good.
And I thought, wow. Never been asked that before. That was really neat.
Well, it's kind of how we talked last week. You know, we are Christians and we're proud that we're Christians, and it's a wonderful, beautiful name, but it's been, what do you call it? Watered down to not mean as much. Everyone says they're a Christian. Generalized, I guess, is the good word, Heidi. Thank you. Yeah, it doesn't mean what it used to mean in when they were first called Christians in Antioch. It's like I said last week, I was a Christian. I said I was a Christian before I was a Christian. I was born in America. Everybody's a Christian. Well, everybody wears crosses. And what does that mean? And that's a really good question, Georgie, for her to ask you, and we could ask that too, if we run across someone that's wearing a cross.
It's quite custom jewelry these days.
Yeah.
In middle school, yeah, all the kids have crosses.
Sure they do.
Crosses.
Does that cross mean anything to you? Mm-hmm. That's a great question.
Yeah, I thought it was true.
And then if they answer in a way that you could also say, you know what, let me tell you what it means. Mm-hmm. We should take advantage of those opportunities. I love that.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you. I'm glad that lady did that. Because that's something we can all do now.
Yeah.
But this pastor was saying, we don't have a problem wearing crosses, but he says we should all wear a towel around our neck. A towel represents what?
Service.
And sweat.
Yeah.
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm. And why don't we wear towels? Oh, because we're saved by grace, right, Heidi? We're saved. It's not by works. So, you know, I've got my ticket to heaven. I'm going to stretch out and relax here now. No. No, because we are saved by grace, we of all people should be imitators of Christ. And he wore a towel. Right. So marks of humility. All right. He was the prime example of humility, wasn't he? The Lord Jesus Christ for us. I'm going to read these marks of humility. And I want you to, as I read them, think about yourself. We're not going to talk about it or anything. But I just really, when I was reading through these, I'm thinking, whoa, do I have a way to go here? Number one is, if you are a humble person, you have the willingness to perform the lowest service for Jesus' sake. The lowest service. I've told you the story about my friend Tammy Zimmerman.
There was a band playing, and the kids played instruments, and they had electric guitars and acoustic guitars and a keyboard and drums and cymbals and all this wonderful stuff. It was a very alive, active youth group. And I'm sure they probably had, I think at one time there was even a saxophone player. I mean, it was amazing. And they were in there, and those kids, it was my daughter's youth group, and they were lifting their hands and singing and praising and worshiping the Lord with all they had. And it was such a beautiful thing. I walked in, and I felt like I had stepped inside heaven itself. You know, it was just an incredible experience. And I walked around the back of those kids and went around the corner, and I saw someone in the toilet. Scouring this toilet and scrubbing out the, I don't know, hard water deposits while these kids were worshiping. Now that had a profound impact on me. I don't think Tammy even probably remembers that day, but I remember it. That, and the Lord spoke to me when I saw that, and he said, do you see what's going on out there? I said, yes, Lord, they're worshiping. And he said, and that's worship too. That is worship too. Okay, that's a humble person. And not to embarrass anyone in this room, but our pastor's wife, Cheryl, you guys wouldn't even believe some of the things I've seen her
She's
do.
Not, she might be the pastor's wife, but she's not too good to clean out a toilet. And I just want to honor you with that. Thank you. Thank you for being who you are. Thank you for wearing a towel. And you are an example to all of us. So, but anyway, so now consciousness. Okay, if you're a person of humility, you have a consciousness of your own inability to do anything apart from God.
A truly humble person has the willingness to perform the lowest service for Jesus' sake. A truly humble person has a consciousness of his or her own inability to do anything apart from God.
knowing that you can do nothing without Christ. Do you know we can't even take our next breath without him? He gives us breath. And if he says we're going to stop breathing, that's when we stop breathing. So even something as simple as breathing. Number three, a truly humble person has the willingness to be ignored or unappreciated. Do you ever feel unappreciated? I think we all do.
If you're a mother.
If you're a mother, for sure. They just take us for granted.
Forever unappreciated.
Right. Forever. Not just after they grow up. But, I mean, before they grow up. But no, kidding. And then the last one is being truly others-centered rather than self-centered. We're Christ-centered first, right? Always Christ-centered. And when we're Christ-centered, he is the one that draws us to be others-centered. I hear snoring going on behind me. It's not me. I want everyone to know it's a dog. It's, what's her name? Toots? Toots is snoring.
In the world.
There are the kind that walk into the room and say, "Here I am." And then there's the kind. There are the kind who walk into the world or into the room and say, "There you are. There you are. There you are." What kind of person do you
want? Here I am.
Or there you are. Something to think about. How do we maintain that humility? You know, one of the best ways that we can do that is to have an accountability partner. Someone that will hold you accountable. Yeah, isn't it? Because we all have blind spots. And how good it would be to have a friend come alongside you and say, and you know, you have a relationship built with that person. And so you're comfortable with them. There are certain people you could not receive that kind of thing from. You know, here, let me help you pick the log out of your eye. You know, well, you know, it depends on who you are, whether I'm going to let you do that. You know, relationship. Relationship has to be the foundation. Do you have someone who is discipling you, mentoring you, helping you through the walk? You know, someone that maybe has known the Lord, walked with the Lord a little longer, a little wiser. That's who Awanda has been to me for years. Sharon was my Timothy because I led her to Christ. And she grew so fast that she just took off like wildfire. But then she became like a Barnabas to me. She was no longer Timothy. She was Barnabas. We just walked together. And, but we all need to have someone bring people to you whom you can mentor. And the Lord will bring people to you who could be your Paul. But I think we should all keep our eyes and ears open because I think it's very important that we have both going on in our lives, because that's what keeps us sharpened for him and keeps us effective and keeps us from losing our, you know, we've got to be on our toes. If you've ever been a mentor to anyone, some of the questions they ask you, they're great. They're great questions, and they really cause you to seek out answers in God's word, which is good. It stretches us, doesn't it? But we also need that one to go to. So verse 6 then says, read verse 6. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Spurgeon has a lot of writings too out there. This is what he said about that. In the body of Christ, the way up is to go down. You want to be great in God's kingdom? Learn to be a servant of all. And then he goes on, he says, but he that is ambitious to be at the top will find himself before long at the bottom.
Verse 7,
casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Okay, so if a guy comes to help you move your furniture, and he's got this big backpack on his back, and he's moving your stuff, and you're looking at him going, sir, are you crazy? Take that load off so you can do what I need you to do, right? I mean, it doesn't make sense. But in the same way, we can't do that either. We cannot do God's work when we're weighted down by our own burdens and worries. And it takes both hands. We're not, he doesn't say here, he uses the word king, signifies force. You know, like, and it almost takes two hands, right? Mm. It's not, he doesn't say lay your burdens at the cross. Cast them. Mm. When I hear the word cast, to me it has power behind it. It's an energetic word, isn't it? And it takes two hands, the hand of prayer. Have you ever had to cast something? I have. I mean, something that was almost physically painful for me to deal with, number one, and it was painful for me to cast it. You cry out in prayer. You just go, ugh, and I have done that before. Take it. Just take it, Lord. And then the hand of faith. So the hand of prayer and the hand of faith. And you just shove them away and you put them onto him, because he says, take upon yourself my burden. My burden is, my yoke is easy and my burden is light, right? It's like the guy with the, helping you move with the big backpack on. How can you do, God is saying to us, how can you do that? How can you do what I've called you to do? When you're carrying that burden, cast it with the hand of faith, the hand of prayer. Cast it on me and let me handle it. Let me do that for you, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And it reflects poorly on our God, doesn't it? When we carry that reflect on the mighty God that we claim to serve. How does the world perceive that? Talking about being examples. Unbelievers, how do they see that? When they see a Christian walking around like he or she has been baptized in pickle juice. How does that look to them? And think of how, if we can just say, I don't like this. We can be honest. I don't like what's happening right now. It stinks. But I know my God. Like the children in the fiery furnace. My God is able. But if not, like Job said, yet will I serve him. How powerful is that? What a powerful testimony that is to unbelievers and believers alike. To me, I think it's very faith-building when I encounter a Christian who's struggling and they have that attitude. It helps me immensely. And in a strange sort of way, it builds my faith. But it's okay to be honest. I mean, really, should as Christians, should we walk around and say, oh, life is good, life is wonderful? And I think there are, especially in the area where we live, there's a lot of that going on. That the happier I am and the more perfect my life is, the more I'm blessed. And all is good. No, we don't want to be Stepford wives. We can be real, right? We can be real people. This hurts. I am not denying that, but I know my God, and he will carry me through this. What a testimony. Let's look at verse 8. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Ooh, I don't like that verse at all. Because he's not looking like these dogs that Kara has here, and Brutus and Bella. He doesn't just want to lick at us and nibble. He wants to devour. That's why it says in Ephesians for us to walk circumspectly. Walk always looking. He studies us. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our propensities. He does, and he uses them.
You know, nowadays, people don't like to say that Satan is like a roaring liar going about, a roaring lion. He's a liar too, but
yeah.
But going about devouring. They don't want to even admit that Satan is doing anything.
No.
And that is him winning over.
He is winning.
That's a tool. He comes clothed as everything that you desire, not
right.
As,
he does.
And that's what I was going to say. We live in a society where it's made to be something that's okay, funny. You know, Satan's just a red little guy with a
horns and a tail.
Yeah, and he's just sitting on the side of your shoulder laughing a little bit.
Yeah.
But if you've ever had a real encounter with, you know, you realize that there are things that you should not mess around with.
Yes.
And you don't mess around with that.
You don't even open the door a crack.
No.
He's going to be locked up, right, for 1,000 years. But he's not locked up right now. And he's gunning for us. He is not omnipresent like God. We often think he is. He's
he
not.
Knows what you're thinking, and he doesn't.
No, he doesn't know what we're thinking. But he has a lot of associates who are all over the world sending messages to him, and they study us and they know us, and so through them, the demons, we're in spiritual warfare, people. His influence extends all over the world in every arena of life, even in the church. Or you see someone wearing a necklace and you're, oh, I really like that necklace. I wonder what it looks like in front. You know, there's a lot of those kinds of things. But, you know, if it's a church where
the... I got a solution.
What?
Sit in the front row.
Sit in the front, then you don't know. That's right. That's where you are, isn't it? That is where you are. For believers, he might have a roar, but he's been defanged. He was defanged at the cross. He has no power over us if we have been covered with the blood of Jesus. He's like a chihuahua with a megaphone. You know chihuahuas, how they are, right? Aren't they? Aren't they just kind of high strung? And he's got a megaphone. He's just a chihuahua. He reminds me of the wizard on The Wizard of Oz. Remember how scared they were? Even the lion, and he's going like this with his tail and shaking and quivering. And then what happens? Toto goes over and pulls the curtain open. It's this little wimp of a guy. That's who the enemy is to us. If we're believers, we don't have to be afraid. Another quote from Spurgeon. Listen to this. He can never be content till he sees the believer utterly devoured. He would rend him in pieces and break his bones and utterly destroy him if he could. Do not, therefore, indulge the thought that the main purpose of Satan is to make you miserable. It's not, I thought when I read that. Thought it was. I thought that was his main purpose, was to make me miserable. But he goes on and he says, he is pleased with that. Yeah, he's pleased with making us miserable. But that is not his ultimate end. Sometimes he may even make you have dainty poisons, sweet to the taste, which he administers to God's people. Here, have a morsel. It's good. If he feels that our destruction can be more readily achieved by sweets than by bitters, he certainly would prefer that which would best affect his end. Remember, he comes as an angel of light. He doesn't come to us with a pitchfork and horns. Spurgeon says, resist. God tells us that too. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Be more prayerful every time he is more active. What if we did that? Well, I'm going to finish this quote. He will soon give it up. If he finds that his attacks drive you to Christ, often has Satan been nothing but a big black dog to drive Christ's sheep nearer to the master. How long is he going to keep torturing you if he hears you go to the master every single time? You think he's going to keep it up? No, I don't. I want to speak it out because, like Heidi said, he's not omniscient. I feel like he needs to hear it. And even if you're standing in the room alone, speak it out. Get behind me, Satan.
I'm so glad that we can boldly approach the throne of grace because of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. Hallelujah.
Yes.
What a gift. What a gift. I mean, he opened the way for women. You know, we are not in that position of having to go through a man, and what a wonderful gift that is. Or a priest or anyone else. You know, that curtain was torn, wasn't it? From the top to the bottom. Verse 10. In his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. Oh, I love that. A firm foundation. My life verse is Psalm 40, 1 through 3. Can we turn there just for a minute? Have you ever had to wait patiently for the Lord? You've asked him something, you've been through something, and it says, he heard my cry. He will hear your cry. He will bring you out of the horrible pit. And where will he set your feet? You're sinking in quicksand. You're in quicksand. That's the horrible pit of miry clay. It says, he will set my feet upon a rock. Who is that rock? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's our rock. And he will set our feet upon him, and he will establish our steps. I think about a little baby that's just learning to walk, and they're toddling along, and they fall, and they struggle with their, you know, limbs cooperating. And we steady them. We pick them up, and we steady them. That's what he does for us. He establishes our steps. He puts a new song in our mouth. Many will see it in fear and put their trust in him. I want a new song. And that's what he did for me. He put a new song. He put a new story in my mouth. I'm not a singer, but he put a new story in my mouth. And it's one of praise to my God and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I will shout it from the rooftops. I want everyone to know what he's done for me. And it says here, in verse 10, he will place you on a firm foundation. And typical of Peter, I just love Peter. I know I'm like Peter. He can't just shut up. You know? He goes on. He says the amen. And then furthermore, and he goes on and on. Do you remember we were studying James? What did he do? What did James do at the very end? Stopped. You know, no, goodbye, nothing. It's like, I've told you what to do, now do it.
And he says, after you have suffered a little while, I don't like that. I would just as soon do away with that, wouldn't you? Mm-hmm. We wish we were called to eternal glory on the no suffering plan, right? But the truth remains that the only way to glory is to go through a few hardships, right? But he, through it all, is worthy of our praise, and to him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. That's what he says. He's still, in spite of all of that, through all the suffering, he's worthy of our praise. And then he goes on to his final greetings, and we won't spend a lot of time on those, but verses 12 on, he tells you, my purpose in writing is to encourage you and assure you that what you are experiencing is truly part of God's grace for you. Stand firm in
His grace,
no matter what. Be humble. Your sister church here in Babylon send you greetings. We're a church in Hebron. We have sister churches all over the place. We have, of course, Joshua Springs is our sister church, and the Gooding Springs and all that. But we have sister churches here. We have other churches in this community who worship the Lord Jesus Christ, Benning, that they might have called a pastor. That makes me happy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I feel better. There's something about sister churches, meaning those of us, those churches here who are evangelical and we love the Lord and we serve him and we have that connection with them. And there are several. When I hear something good about one of them, like this one, like they finally have a pastor, I didn't even realize how much it was bothering me that they didn't. And I heard that and
said,
yeah, a long time.
I didn't realize they didn't have a pastor.
No, they haven't for a long time. And it's just kind of been, I don't know, kind of, I'm on edge. But anyway, so what happens to one when part of us suffers, all of us suffer, when one of us experiences joy, we all experience joy together. And he talks about, so does my son Mark. That is the mark that was the mark that caused the problem between Barnabas and Paul. Barnabas, the encourager, wanted to give him another chance. And they remember they separated over that. This is the mark. And so Peter is identifying himself with that mark. It's also the mark whose mother, remember when Peter broke out of jail? And, well, the angel broke him out. And he went to that house and knocked. And the Christians were in there praying that Peter would be released. And he's released. And he's knocking on the door. And Rhoda answers it. Well, anyway, that house is Mark's mother's house. That's the mark. And, you know, Rhoda answers. I'm going, Rhoda, let him in. Come on. She goes, she doesn't even let him in. It's like, Peter's out there. You know, goes running back and it's Peter. And they go, oh, you're insane. I love that. I think God has a sense of humor. To me, that's the funniest passage in the whole Bible. But anyway, that was Mark's mom. So Peter is identifying, you know, he obviously had a good relationship with Mark. And then verse 14, greet each other with a kiss of love. Peace be with all of you who are in Christ. Peter concludes with a command to greet one another with that display. And he's actually pronouncing a blessing. And it's a kiss of greeting that already existed. That was part of their culture. It's really not part of our culture. We don't do that, do we? Do we kiss each other? No. In fact, there are a lot of Americans who don't even want to be touched. You know, just don't touch me. And I'm a hugger and a scratcher, right? And so it's really, you know, hard to know as an American, are they a hugger and a scratcher or not? You know, it's one thing I love about Cheryl. So before you leave tonight, she's going to give every one of you a hug because that's just what Cheryl does. And I love that. But greet one another with a holy kiss. He's sanctioning that as a way to demonstrate love and affection for brothers and sisters in Christ. We don't do that so much. We were talking, well, actually, Pastor Mike mentioned it in church yesterday. What do they do in the Philippines?
Monopole.
And you hold your hand up. Demonstrate that for everybody.
Oh.
Can you see? Do it again.
Oh.
Yeah, the younger person. That's a way of showing honor. So, you know, we could
do
that.
But it's just that special way of showing love for one another. So, two things. Love for each other and peace. That's what he closes with.
Those are especially necessary if we're going to be suffering, which we are. We know there are hard days ahead. Peter knew that too. And he knew that we were going to need to uphold one another, love one another, and we need peace every bit as much as those Christians did at that time who were being persecuted. Because attacks against Christians are growing worldwide, aren't they? Remember the man that signed the Declaration of Independence, I believe. I don't remember his name, but he said, "United we stand, divided we fall." And it's the same for the body of Christ. And the verse in Ecclesiastes that says, "A cord of three strands cannot easily be broken." That's you and me and Jesus Christ cannot be broken. So let's love one another unconditionally. And let's stand together, united in Christ Jesus our Lord. Makes me think of the old song. And I think we should close with that. 1 John 4:7-8. Do you know the verse? "Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Beloved, let us love one another." 1 John 4:7-8. So let's love one another as Christ Jesus has loved us. Let's close in prayer.